Okay, very good morning to all of you. And first of all, thanks to the director and the head of the department and the organizers for inviting me to this prestigious institute and giving me an opportunity to talk to you about my research and my experiences in the area of underwater robotics. It's a really a nice place to be here, be there, because coming from Chennai, which is a hot place, and I can see that this itself is a nice place for me. Very cold, at least comparatively from Chennai, it's a very cold place. And I like this climate very much, and thanks for giving me this opportunity to come here and visit this place. So as told to you by the in the introduction, I work in IIT Madras in the Department of Engineering Design. I'm basically a mechanical engineer, and then I did my B.Tech and M.Tech in mechanical engineering, and then moved to robotics for my PhD, and after PhD I worked in underwater robotics for 6 years in Singapore, and then came back to IIT Madras as a faculty. So for the last 8 years I am there at IIT Madras working in the area of robotics. So most of you may be knowing what is robotics, because that's a very fascinating field. There are whenever you talk about robotics and you say that there is a seminar or workshop on robotics, you can see there are a lot of interest in students to know more about robotics and to be part of robotic technologies. The only issue of what I find with the student community is that they have a very limited notion of robotics. They feel that, okay, you make something, if it starts moving, yeah, that's all the robotics is. I am a robotic expert, so I don't need to go any more further. So that's why you will see that at the undergraduate level, there will be a lot of interest in robotics for students. As they know more about robotics, they'll realize, oh, this is not my field. Let me move away from that, because it's a lot of, you need a lot of expertise in various fields. You need to be a good mechanical engineer. You need to be a good electrical engineer. You need to be good in electronics. You need to be good in controls. You need to be good in communications. So if you want to be a very good robotics person, you need to know a bit of all these areas. So that is one of the reasons why we feel that the robotics is not picking up the way we want it to go. We expect robotics, robots to be there everywhere in our day-to-day life, but unfortunately that is not happening. So when I was a student, my teachers used to tell, by the time in another 20 years, you will see robots delivering milk at your home, robots delivering newspapers, robots as domestic assistants. Unfortunately, the things did not happen that way, because the focus of robotics changed, and then there was a lot of other issues. As I mentioned, the requirement of interdisciplinary professionals to carry out research and then find new applications and bring it to the human, or to around the human beings, or in the middle of human beings, that was not really happening. So this is one of the challenges what the robotic scientists and robotic engineers are facing all over the world. How do we actually bring robots close to the human, which is one of the biggest challenges. Of course, my topic or the talk is not on that aspect, but I just wanted to give you an introduction about what is happening in the robotics area and why we need more and more people to work in this area, develop new technologies, new principles, and new applications, so that we can see more and more robots amongst the human and probably helping the human in various fields. And of course, underwater robot is also a robot which is going to help the human beings, but we have multiple challenges in developing these robots as human-friendly as possible. So what I'm going to do in this talk is basically to give you a brief introduction about underwater robots, because next, today and tomorrow, you're going to have more lectures on control aspects. So I'll touch upon some of the basics of robots and how do you actually design a robot, how do you start the basic modeling of a robot and understand the basic dynamics of robot. And then slowly we can actually learn about how do you develop control systems, how do you develop more and good controllers and make it more and more autonomous. So that is the challenge. How do you make it a fully autonomous robot? So this is going to be the rough outline of my talk. So I'll be talking basically about the introduction about the underwater robots, what are the classification of underwater robots or underwater vehicles, and then how do you actually start building different kinds of robots. There are different classifications. And then I will talk about the autopilot design, basically how do you make it fully autonomous. And as part of that autopilot design, we'll talk about the dynamic modeling of dynamics, then design of controllers, and what do you mean by control guidance and navigation in autonomous robots. And I'll be talking some of the research issues what that we addressed, like path tracking control, obstacle avoidance, simulation studies using hardware in loop, and how do you design and model robots with the manipulator systems. And probably in another 1.5 hours to 2 hours, I'll be able to cover these topics. Please feel free to ask questions in case you have need to know more about any particular aspect or a particular topic, or you have some questions, please feel free to stop me and ask question, because this is not going to be something I just tell something and go away. I want you to learn something, and you want to I want you to clarify your doubts so that the next sessions will be much more interesting to you, so that you know the fundamentals, so you can build upon those fundamentals and learn more in the next lectures. So before we start the talk about what is robots, let us look at how we started with the underwater vehicles. Okay, not the robots as such, but underwater vehicles. Who actually started about all these things? So it was somewhere in the 16th or early 16th century that conceptual design of a submarine was proposed by in 1578. And that was only a conceptual design. Okay, what could be a vehicle which can actually go underwater and then do some maneuvering and then come up. So that was only a concept. And then the construction of first submarine was almost after 50 years in 1620 by Van Drebel. So that was the first construction of a underwater vehicle, or which is the submarine, first submarine. And the first submarine to be used in war was 1776. You can see from the first construction of a submarine, it took almost 150 years for it to be practical, to use it in a practical application. So the challenges involved in making it useful, that considering the safety aspects, considering the usability of the vehicle, etc. So it took almost 150 years to bring it into the real application. And then slowly things started moving. Once we proved something and we know that something can really work, then people started working on it. Then it actually, the self-propelled torpedo was introduced in 1868. And then the first tethered ROV. So that was by a Russian, 1953. You can see, again, a lot of time elapsed between the torpedo and to a remotely operated vehicle. ROV stands for a remotely operated vehicle. It is a kind of a robot. So that was the first tethered ROV. It was in 1953. So it was a Cold War period. So once Russians make something, US need to make something. So Americans came up immediately with a cable-controlled underwater vehicle in 1958. So it's almost the same, only the names changed. So a tethered ROV and cable-controlled underwater vehicle are almost the same. So that was in 1958. And then after that, people started, okay, now we have a cable-controlled one. So how do we actually remove the cable and put make it autonomous? So then US Navy started working on cable-controlled recovery vehicle. And then a special purpose underwater research vehicle by University of Washington in 1957. And then probably the first autonomous underwater vehicle was designed by MIT in 1970. So that was the real robot, autonomous robot, which actually came into the public field or the public domain in 1970. And after that, of course, a lot of research is going on. There are a lot of researchers, a lot of research universities working in this area of developing more and more autonomy, or how do you give more and more autonomy to these robots. So that is the present work. How do you make it more autonomous, better controllers, and better application, more maneuverability, more endurance, and so these are all the challenges being worked out by scientists at present. So that's just a brief history of how we started with the conceptual design of a submarine to an underwater autonomous vehicle. So what do we need the underwater robots first of all? Okay, what is the reason why we thought of going for underwater robots? And most of you know, how many of you know swimming? Okay, so what will happen as you go deep? Pressure increases, right? So there is a limit to which the human body can actually withstand. So beyond that, you won't be able to meet the body, won't be able to overcome or to face the pressure. So that is one of the main challenge in underwater application. As you go deep, the pressure increases. Every 10 meter, you will get 1 bar pressure. So as you go deep, the pressure keep on increasing. And therefore, you can see that up to 60 meter only is diving is allowed or possible. Okay, and beyond that, you need to get some kind of a support from somebody or some vehicle to go deeper. So surface ship supply diving or diving from the bell or submarine, it's not possible only up to this period, this depth. And beyond that, you cannot really have a human going directly into water. You cannot have unless you have a protection. And that is where the remotely operated vehicle and other kind of vehicles coming into picture. So this range, 600 to 3000 meters, we can really use robotic vehicles to carry out tasks. And beyond that, of course, you need to have much more compact and much more suitable vehicles. Deep submarines and other vehicles are being used beyond that depth. So in this area, it's not possible for human to do any task. Therefore, you need to go for vehicles or remotely operated vehicle or fully autonomous robotic vehicle, which can be used for meaningful tasks, because many of our task requirement is around this region. So we need to have some vehicles to support the human. So an underwater robot is basically a mobile device, a mobile robotic device designed and developed to work in underwater environments to accomplish specific tasks which are normally performed by human operators. So that is a simple definition that you can give for an underwater robot. It's simply a mobile robotic device. And of course, you can program it and you can actually control it. So it can actually accomplish specific tasks. So most of the time, it could be an observation kind of a task or surveillance, or you want to use it for doing some repair or some kind of other operation like opening a valve or closing a valve, or you just want to do an underwater welding of a pipeline, or you just want to do an inspection. So these are some of the tasks which actually can be carried out by robots, which are normally performed by human operators, but which can actually be given to a robotic device so that this device will be able to do such tasks. That is the way we simply define underwater robots. Now, these are the reasons why we actually, the commercial reason, okay, there are, apart from the requirement as in terms of the technical challenges, there are commercial reasons also why we go for underwater robots. So it's a very big industry. Underwater industry is a huge one. There are a lot of underwater construction, underwater structures, pipelines, cables. You have a lot of communication cables, oil and gas pipelines, underwater structures for oil rigs and et cetera, et cetera. So it's a very big industry and there are a lot of investment there. And therefore, we can have a lot of potential in using robots in this area. And another one is, task is performed under structured condition. So most of the things are very structured. So one of the requirements for a robot application is that things should be very structured. I mean, at least at this stage, we cannot have a very random or a fuzzy environment for the robot to work. If the things are very structured, you know where it is and what is available there, then probably you can use a robot to go there. So most of the underwater pipelines, we know where it is. Underwater connection, I mean, structures, we know what kind of structures are there. So that means it is more or less a structured environment. And therefore, it is possible to use robot to do the task. And of course, we need a lot of extended surveys and extension of pipelines, et cetera, et cetera. So they can actually overcome that one using underwater robots. And these are some of the universities and the industry which actually work in this area in developing robots. Like University of Tokyo has got a very big underwater robotics program. And MIT in the US, then Hawaii University, Woodsville Oceanographic Institute. So like that, there are many institutes which actually work in this area of underwater robots. Then there are industries also working on developing manipulators, developing robots, developing underwater systems. So there are many industries which actually are involved in this kind of development task. So how do we actually classify these kind of vehicles into robots and non-robot vehicles? So you can see, if you look at the underwater vehicles, we can classify them into two major categories as manned vehicles and unmanned vehicles. Manned vehicles are basically the submarines, and then there is something called a human-occupied vehicle. And in unmanned, we have many categories like towed vehicle, remotely operated vehicle, unmanned tethered vehicle, underwater gliders, bottom crawlers, and autonomous underwater vehicles. So these are the manned vehicles and these are the unmanned vehicles. Sorry, these are the manned vehicles, these are the unmanned vehicles. And our focus is mostly on this remotely operated vehicle and then the autonomous underwater vehicle. These are the two robotic category vehicles. Others are not really robots because this is towed by another vehicle. And this is to some extent ROV only. There's not much of difference. Only thing, the tether is removed from here. And this is a glider. It's again a kind of robotic device. But mostly we'll be focusing on these two remotely operated vehicle and autonomous underwater vehicle, which are basically the unmanned underwater vehicle, because there are no human beings in the vehicle when it goes into the water. So let us look into these categories, and we will see that the evolution of the robotic vehicle, the autonomous underwater vehicle, actually started with human occupied vehicle. Okay, so, and from human occupied vehicle, it moved to remotely operated vehicle and then to the autonomous underwater vehicle. So that was the way the things progress. So we cannot directly jump into a totally autonomous vehicle. We need to start with something and then slowly move, slowly include the autonomy, more and more autonomy, you get the fully autonomous vehicle. So let us look at the first vehicle, the human occupied vehicle, which was the predecessor for the remotely operated vehicle. So this kind of vehicle is still being used. So it is, it's not a submarine, it's not a robot also, because there are people inside. So it's like a vehicle which is fully sealed from outside in pressure, with the pressure casing, so that no pressure effects will be there. But there will be human inside, so there is a human occupation space here, and then human can control the whole vehicle. It's like you have a car which is fully sealed and then you can actually go into the water. So that kind of a system is the human occupied vehicle. So it has got the thrusters. So these are known as the thrusters, which actually provide the power. So you move the water and then create the momentum so that it will actually move. So it has got thrusters, side thrusters, and forward and backward thrusters. And then it has got batteries and navigation systems, manipulator, and a sample basket, which can actually collect sample water samples or the sample from the bottom of the sea. So that kind of application, this kind of vehicle has got. So this is one of the vehicle which is available with the Woods Hole Oceanographic Institute in the US, Alvin. It's a human occupied vehicle. So this was the first kind of vehicle being used for underwater applications. And then people realize that it's not so safe to have human inside. So something goes wrong, the safety of the person is at risk, and we need to have something to replace the human from here. So that was the point when researchers thought of, okay, how do we actually remove the human from there? How do we remove the human? What will we do? Yeah, we see that, okay, why should I sit there? Let me sit somewhere else and do the control of the vehicle. Okay, so that is basically the remote operation. So now people are thinking, okay, why should I have a driver to take my car to from my home to this place? Can I have something to replace the driver? Yeah, so that kind of a concept. So we are trying to see, I mean, people are trying to think, okay, if I can remove this human from here, then I can actually go much more deeper. Okay, I'm not worried about safety, because even if it fails, okay, nothing will happen to me, and nothing happens to the human. So we'll have much more freedom to do this operation, underwater operation. So that is when people thought of removing the human from this place, and then giving the control to a person who is sitting at another location. And that is what, that was the result when we had the category of robotic vehicles. Okay, so that is the first one. I'll come back to this slide later. So that was the remotely operated vehicle. So in remotely operated vehicle, you can see that the shape and other things can remain the same. The only thing is that there is no place for the human to sit inside. Okay, that means human operator has been removed from the vehicle, and he has been moved to a remote location. And all the control signal and power supply were given from another point through a cable called tether. So that is the tether or umbilical cord or whatever you call it is. So that was the difference between a human occupied vehicle and a remotely operated vehicle. So in remotely operated vehicle, you will see a tether which actually carry the control signals. I mean, whatever you want to control, you can send the signal from a remote location, and then the controller can be inside. So you can have enough control motors and actuators inside, and you can have enough sensors to get the information. So you take all the information through the camera, sensors, and other camera and other sensors, pass this information to the operator who is sitting at a remote location, provide him all the feedback, tell him where the robot vehicle is, what the vehicle is seeing, what is the pressure, what is the temperature, what is there any obstacle. Information you give to the operator sitting at a remote location, and then based on this information, he can decide whether he has to operate this thruster or this thruster, or he has to do something with the manipulator. Everything can be decided, and then he gives the signal to these thrusters and the thing will move. That was the basically a remotely operated vehicle. So you remove the human being and change the operation to a remote location, that is remote operation of vehicle or remotely operated vehicle. So here, what we need is a mothership or a vehicle which can actually be connected to this robot. So the operator will be sitting in a ship on the surface of the sea, and then from this mothership, the robot will be deployed, and all the signals will be passed through this. So then you don't need a battery also, because power supply also can come here. So you can actually have a very extended duration of survey also, or the operation, because power supply is already coming from the outside. So you'll give the signal and then control it, and then it will move forward. Okay, so cable through which communications, data transmission, and power supply are carried out. So that was the difference between a human occupied vehicle and a remotely operated vehicle. So it has got thrusters, navigation system, sample basket, tether, manipulator arm, onboard computer, cameras, and it does not have a personal sphere and batteries. So that is the difference between a human occupied vehicle and a remotely operated vehicle. So what are the challenges, or what are the difficulties now when you, okay, you have removed the human being, but then you bring in many other difficulties, right? So you try to, and that is the way how the new development takes place. You try to remove some problem, then you get into more problem, then you try to have solve that problem, then you develop more problem. But as you progress, you will develop many things, and the technology will keep improving. So that is the way how things work. So when you had this one, then you saved the human from risk, then you had the extended survey possible, but along with that, it actually came with many other difficulties. Because the operating range is restricted because of the tether. So you have more, you want to have far away from the mothership, you would have a very long tether. So, and when you have a long tether, that actually creates more problem, because this tether will get entangled with something, or it will actually try to pull the robot, because it will have just about its own mass and inertia. So all those things actually started creating problem. And the mothership to follow the ROV because of the restricted cable length. And pilot needs to be trained well. That was another thing, because now pilot is not seeing anything really physically, 3D, he is not getting anything, but he is getting only through the sensors. So he needs to have a very good training before we really start operating. It is like operating, doing a game, the visual display. You make a lot of mistakes because you don't know where it is really going, what it is happening. So that kind of a problem is there when you have a remote operation. And tether management is the one challenge. I'll tell you what you mean by tether management. And of course, it was operationally efficient compared to other class of vehicles, because it has the efficiency increased because we have got long duration, and pilot need not be there, so we can actually improve many other features. That's why the operational efficiency increased. So the tether management, let me see whether I have it. Yeah, so this is the real kind of a remotely operated vehicle. So it's a commercially, so remote operated vehicle, ROV technology has come to kind of a saturation or maturity. Now we can actually go and buy a remote ROV from the market. So that much of maturity has come to the technology. There are many companies which actually manufacture ROVs. So if a company wants to buy, if somebody wants to buy an ROV, you can actually go and get it from the market with their own specifications. So that much technology is available. So this is how it works. So you have a mothership here. And then there will be a primary cable on which will be connected to the ship from where the ROV will be deployed. And the ROV will be inside, and from here, it will be deployed. The ROV will be moving into the water. And the pilot will be sitting in the ship. And as the tether is, the vehicle is controlled, the tether will also will be removed and or wind up or released depending on the way it is moving. So on the top of the ROV, you can see this is kind of a tether management system or TMS. So that's a tether is long cable. So as the vehicle moves, you need to have some kind of a controlled release of the tether. So you cannot keep it completely free, or you cannot keep it completely tight also. So that is known as basically a tether management system. So this tether management system is one of the biggest challenge in robotics, I mean remotely operated vehicle. So you need to control the tether, you have to make sure that there is not much of pulling force on the ROV because of the tether forces. So all those things need to be properly controlled so that you will get a good operation of remote ROV. And they are being used for various applications. So as I told you, it is commercially available. You can actually use it for various application of inspection, pipeline inspection, survey, drilling support, construction support, etc., etc. That is more or less a mature technology. Of course, a lot of research is still going on, but still we can say that it is commercially available. That is the status of ROV. Okay, so logically, now people are thinking, okay, what should be the next development? So the next development should be remove the cable, right? So how do we remove the cable? That was everything. Okay, cable is creating a lot of problem. So how do we remove the cable? There are many ways to do that, right? If I remove the cable, what should be there? Yeah, you need to have communication, okay? So one thing is that you need to communicate with the robot, okay? How do you communicate? Second one is power supply. Of course, if you assume that the power supply can be there inside, then the question is only communication. So you need to get all the information from the robot and then pass all the information back to the, I mean, control signal back to the robot. So this is a big challenge because underwater communication is still a very, not at all developed area, or we don't have that much of a good system which can communicate very effectively in water. Okay? We have, we can use a sonar signal, or you can have to some extent radio signals to be used, but no, they are all very limited range and they have a very low bandwidth. So you cannot transfer lot of data through underwater medium or water medium. It's very impossible to have long range communication of large data, and therefore when you remove the cable, you cannot have a communication, and therefore we need to have a different way of thinking. How do we remove the cable from the robots? So what can we do? Now I don't want the cable, but I don't have the communication also. What can I do? So I need to make that it is a intelligent one. Okay. So I don't need to keep telling the robot, okay, you do this. So I teach the robot, I'll have a intelligence built into the robot saying that, okay, if you see an obstacle, you do this. If you see a pipeline, you follow and inspect the pipeline. Or if you see some crack, you do a welding. So all these things, if I can build into the robots, then I don't need to have a communication. What I need to see, I just sit there and see whether it is alive or not. If I get some communication, some beeps from the robot saying that, okay, it is alive, it is working, that much only I need to know if I can put all the intelligence into the robots so that it is a fully autonomous robot. So the next logical one was, if you don't want a cable, you don't have the communication capability, then you make it fully intelligent so that you can just release it and get the things done. So that is basically the autonomous underwater vehicle. So from human occupied vehicle to remotely operated vehicle, we move to autonomous underwater vehicle, which is the third category of vehicle, which is a robotic device that is driven through the water by a propulsion system, controlled and piloted by an onboard computer, and maneuverable in all the three dimensions. So that is basically an autonomous underwater vehicle. So it's a robotic device as like other devices, but the only thing is that controlled and piloted by an onboard computer. So you have an onboard computer which can actually be used for controlling and piloting the robots. Then you get an autonomous underwater robot, and it is maneuverable in three dimensions. That means it has got all the 6 degrees of freedom of motion, and all these 6 degrees of freedom motion can be controlled and piloted by an onboard computer. That is basically an autonomous underwater vehicle. All right? Okay, so what we need here, it needs to be pre-programmed. So you need to know what the robot is going to do. Accordingly, you need to make a complete program saying that, okay, I am releasing it from point A, and then after release, it will go to point B, it will check for something, and then return the message, and then it will go to point B, then go to point C, and after that, it come back to the original location. So that is fully programmed, and all the instructions are given to the robot what to do. And here, the degree of human intervention will be a function of communication capability. So that the human intervention, what we can do is only very limited. So maybe a limited communication capability saying that, okay, if something is not working, probably the robot will be able to send a message to the control station through sonar signals or some other signal. And that much of limited capability will be there. So to have that, what we need is a foolproof navigation control and guidance system on board to meet the mission accuracy requirements. So what we need is a foolproof navigation guidance and control system. So unless you have a navigation guidance and control system which is very robust and very efficient, you won't be able to get the autonomous operation of a vehicle. So the foolproof navigation control and guidance system is the most important, or the brain of the system to get the vehicle accuracy requirements. And transmission of data back to the ship onboard data storage with post-mission retrieval does not meet the mission requirement. But this is only a requirement. If suppose you want some data to come in between, then probably you need to have that kind of a communication capability. But otherwise, in general, there will not be any communication. And other requirements are there. It has to be safe, that if something goes wrong, the vehicle should come up. It should not go into the water or the depth of the water. You won't be able to get it out. So there are different requirements. As we progress, we'll discuss those issues also. So in between, so now we have a remotely operated vehicle and autonomous underwater vehicle. So the issue now here is that how do you make this possible? Okay, I need to have a highly efficient navigation control and guidance system. Okay? If this is not there, then I am going to lose my vehicle. So after some time, the vehicle will not be knowing where it is, and it will be lost, and then I won't be able to get it. So people are thinking, okay, how do we actually overcome this issue? So that was when people started, instead of going directly for a fully autonomous vehicle, why can't we have a kind of a hybrid vehicle? Okay, so it's not autonomous, it is not remotely operated, but in between you have some kind of autonomy for the vehicle. So that was the category in between. Yeah. So we called it as a hybrid underwater robotic vehicle. So it is in between the ROV and AUV. So as you can see, AUV, the autonomy is very high. So if you take this is the autonomy and this is the complexity of the task it can perform, the autonomy is very high for AUV. But unfortunately, it cannot perform very complex tasks because it is autonomous. If it's a remotely operated, we can actually control and get a lot of operation. But here, you won't be able to get a lot of complex tasks carried out by AUV. So that is where people thought of coming up with a hybrid underwater robotic vehicle, which could be an ROV and an AUV, depending on the type of mission. So sometimes it will act as an ROV, sometimes it will act as an AUV. So you have still control on the vehicle, but you don't really need to make it a fully remotely operated vehicle. For example, you make an ROV and you release it from the ship, and then you want this to be used for an inspection of an underwater pipeline. So what we do, we release the ROV, and the pilot will actually take it using the cable connection. It will take it to the pipeline. So once the pipeline is identified, then the pilot will instruct the robot, okay, now it is your job. You just follow the pipeline and get me the report. So I won't do anything. It is your job to go along the pipeline. Wherever there is a pipeline, you just go along that pipeline, inspect it, and get me the information. So we make it a bit of intelligent, but not fully intelligent. So you have many intelligent agents into the system. So you create a lot of agents, small agents, like an obstacle avoidance agent, a pipeline following agent. So like that, you create small modules of intelligence built into the AUV, into the robots, and tell whenever it is possible, you activate these agents, so that the pilot is free of controlling the robot. So that way, you can have a combination of remote operation and the autonomous operation, but at the same time, you still have the full control of the ROV. And as you increase the agents, you keep more and more agents, As you add more intelligence to the system, then it will slowly become a fully autonomous vehicle. So you can convert that into a fully autonomous vehicle. So that is the way how people are working on developing the fully autonomous vehicle, because it is not so safe and easy to go for the fully autonomous operation. So you start with an ROV, build more and more intelligence into the system, make it slowly autonomous, and then finally it will become a fully autonomous vehicle. That was the work I was involved a few years ago. So this was one of the vehicle that we have been we were working on. Basically, this is a hybrid vehicle. It is, you can see there is a tether here. So this is for controlling the robot, and there is no battery because power supply is given from outside, and control signal is also coming from outside. But there are some intelligent agents built into it. So it has got a pipeline following algorithm. So once it identifies a pipeline, then the robot knows, based on the image processing and other techniques, the robot will know, okay, this is a pipeline, and it will keep on following it. It will not, you don't need to really pilot the robots, it will keep on following the, and similarly, when there is a joint, it will know that, okay, where there is a joint, so probably I need to do an inspection, so it will take out the inspection tool and do the inspection. So like that, it will keep on doing it, and once it is completed, or when the robot is not knowing what to do, then it will send a message back to the pilot saying that, oh, I'm lost, help me. Immediately, the pilot can take over the control, and then he will control the robot. So that is the way how the hybrid vehicle works. I hope this video works. It's basically a pool test, a swimming pool test. So it's not working. Is it working there? Just click. Can you go to the directory? Open the directory and then click that. So you can see there is a manipulator on the top of that, and it has got two ports. One is for electronics and one is for the other control equipment. And the thrusters are also shown. So these are the thrusters which actually provide the vertical and side thrust, and there is a thrust at the back side also. So this was one of the hybrid kind of underwater robot vehicle I worked a few years ago. So we were talking about the autonomous underwater vehicle and how the autonomy can be generated. So as you can see here, an autonomous underwater vehicle, it is almost similar to an ROV, except that you don't have a tether. Okay, there is no cable now. The cable has been removed, and there are no human being inside, and all other things remain same. Because you need to have power supply, and you need to have the navigation system, you need to have the controllers, computer, and other things, and you have to have camera, light, and other sensors, collision avoidance system, and a pressure housing for this one to, okay, and the thrusters, and then control planes also. So these are the basic elements of a autonomous underwater vehicle. Now you can see AUV is still a developing area. So you don't still see a commercial AUV available in the market. There are a lot of AUVs being developed in research institutes as on an experimental basis, and few of them are being used for some application, but not on a commercial basis. So this technology is still evolving. And that's why we have a lot of opportunities in developing technologies for AUV. So the main challenge is basically the navigation, control, and guidance. That is one of the things. So how do you get better navigation strategies? How do you have more reliability on the controllers, control system development? And then, of course, guidance systems, also obstacle avoidance and things like that, path planning. So a lot of other challenges. That is what makes the AUV challenging and lot of research opportunities in this area. So let us look at the core of AUV, or the brain of AUV, is the navigation, guidance and control system. So what do you mean by navigation, control, guidance and navigation? So for any autonomous system, whether it is an underwater robot or a ground robot or an aerial robot, the biggest question what the robot needs to ask and answer are, where am I going, how do I get there? Okay. So every robot should know, where am I going and how can I get there? So if I am planning that, telling the robot that, okay, you have to go from A to B. So the robot should know where it is going and how to get there. So if the robot can answer this question, then it will know what to do to reach there. The biggest challenge is that, where am I going? The robot should know, okay, where am I at present? So my present location should be known, and then I can plan for the target. So where am I going actually include the question of where am I at present. So where am I at present, and where am I going, and how do I get there? If the robot can answer these questions, then we'll get the autonomy for the robot. So the control is basically to ensure that the various parameters, performance parameters are achieved in the system. So any controller design for a robot or any other system, you say the controller is basically to ensure that, yes, I have planned something, it is happening. I want the robot to go at 10 kilometer per hour. So the controller will only look at the speed at 10 kilometer or not. If the speed is not 10 kilometer, it will try to adjust it to 10 kilometer. It does not look at any other thing. So it's at the lowest level, it will ensure that whatever you are programmed, it is happening. So that is basically the control, to ensure that the various performance parameters are achieved in the system. That is basically the control. So that is the one which actually ensure that the speed is maintained, direction is maintained, all other parameters, whatever you plan for, it is maintained in the system. And guidance is to ensure that the commanded path is followed by the system. Okay, now you have a commanded path. So the guidance system will ensure that, okay, I am going along the same path which you have asked me to go. Okay, I don't know what is the speed, what is the direction, and all those things. You are telling me to go from A to B in this path. So the guidance system will always ensure that you follow the same path. That is the guidance system. And navigation system basically inform the machine controller system or the main control system about the present status of the vehicle with respect to the commanded position as well as react to environmental changes. So navigation system will take the information from the sensors and pass it to the main control system and tell where is it going and how is it moving and all those things. That is basically how can it react to environmental changes. So suppose there is an obstacle, you plan something, and there is an obstacle, how do you actually overcome that obstacle? So all these things can be planned by the navigation system. So this is basically what is happening in the autonomous system. So you need to have a controller, you need to have a guidance system, you need to have a navigation system, and together all these, the system will be a fully autonomous one. So whether it is a underwater robot or aerial robot, the principle of control, guidance and navigation applies to all kinds of autonomous system. So when we do this, actually we do automatically all these things. Okay, as a human being, we are autonomous bodies. So when I want to do something, I know what I am doing. I have my own control system, I have my own guidance system, and I have my own navigation system. So without our own knowledge, we are actually implementing a control, guidance and navigation in our own system whenever we do a task. So the same thing to be built into a robot to make it fully autonomous. Otherwise, the robot will not be able to do things. So this is what we call it as an autopilot system. Okay, now we have an autopilot. When we have an autopilot, basically we are telling that all these things are put together so that it is on an autopilot mode. So you don't need any intervention from a pilot. So you may have heard about autopilot in aircraft. So aircraft has got an autopilot system. So pilot need not sit anything, you just put it into the autopilot mode. The aircraft has got the intelligent system, it has got the control, navigation and guidance system. So you say that, okay, you have to move from this to this position at a particular speed and a particular altitude. That's all you fix in the aircraft. And then the aircraft sensors will measure all these parameters. It will check whether the parameters are matching with whatever is desired. If it is not meeting, it will keep on adjusting the parameters so that it always maintain the thing. That is basically an autopilot system. So for every autonomous underwater vehicle or every autonomous robots, we need to have a kind of an autopilot system. And that autopilot system actually consists of all these elements. So you'll be having a mission control. In a mission control, basically we tell, okay, what do you want the robot to do? So that is basically the mission controller. So you program this mission control saying that, okay, this is my requirement for the robot to go from A to B, do some inspection and then send signal, and then go from B to C, it will carry something and then come back. So all these things are given to the mission control. So mission controller will having all the information. And then it has got a navigation system with all the sensors like gyroscope, compass, pressure sensor, Doppler velocity log, etc., etc. So this is basically the navigation system will be having all these sensors. And then we have the guidance and control system. Guidance and control, as I told you, the control system will look at the parameters and try to modify it. And the guidance system will try to look at the path and then correct the path. And based on this mission control, the navigation information, and the guidance and control, this system will decide what should be the commanded signal to the actuators. So, you know, the thrusters are the one of the main control element. Thruster can actually, the speed can be increased, direction can be changed, all those things can be changed. So you have the thrusters, rudder and stern planes in the robot. So rudder and stern planes are the control planes which are available on the, apart from the thrusters, you'll be having some flat plate kind of a thing that is basically known as rudders and control planes, which actually help to change the direction of control forces. So based on the navigation signal and vehicle control and guidance information, the robot control will be activated. So the desired commands will be sent to the actuators for controlling the speed, direction, motion, all those things, and you will get the desired motion. And as it moves, it will continuously check whether this is what the information given by this is same as what is given by the reference trajectory, what is needed. That is basically how we get the autopilot implemented. And along with that, you will be having many other information like, you know, communication, data logging, sensors, vehicle safety requirements, all those things are there. So in mission control, there will be something like, suppose you failed, all the system fails. There is a situation that nothing is working in the robots. So what it should do if nothing is working? Yeah, it should come up, right? How will it come up? Because nothing is working. Right? How does it come up? It will go down, right? So you need to design in such a way that it will never go underwater. Okay? So what do? Make it buoyant, right? So you always have a positive buoyancy for the vehicle. That means when you simply left it, it will just come up. It will not go down. So you make it a positively buoyant one. That is one option. But making it positively buoyant always have got some challenges. Basically, suppose you leave something here. So this is the ocean surface. And if it is positively buoyant, it has always a tendency to come up, right? And suppose you want to move in this direction, it will never move. Okay, it will always try to come up. So if you just give a command like this, it will always try to move like this. Because the buoyancy will always try to push it up. So what do you do need to, what do you have to do? So either you need to have a control force which actually will try to overcome this. So that means you spend extra energy to overcome this always. Or you make it buoyant. Okay, you make it just a neutrally buoyant one. Neutrally buoyant is one which actually will remain there. So it will not go up or go down. So it will make, you make it neutrally buoyant. Right? So now if everything fails, what will happen? It will remain there. Right? It's neutrally buoyant. It will remain there. So you need to have some kind of other mechanisms also, safety mechanism. So what kind of mechanism we can think of? A safety mechanism that everything fails, it will come up. Pardon? Okay, there is something called, normally what people use is either make it a positive buoyant. If it's not possible, you make it have some dead weights here. Okay, if everything fails, the pilot, the operator who is sitting, not getting any health signals or signal, there should be a mechanism by which he can send a single signal, okay, a single signal as pulse to this so that something will break here and this weight will fall down. Okay? Once that weight falls down, its buoyancy increases, it will just go up. So that is one kind of a safety mechanism using dead weight. So the dead weight Either the controller can do that. If the controller is not capable of doing this, it will be possible to do it from a remote location, so that you will be able to release a dead weight and then the robot can come up. So that those are the safety, vehicle safety systems to be built in along with the mission control. So it's not only the mission, you need to look at the safety aspect also while we designing the controllers. All right. Okay. So the, from here onwards, it will be slightly more technical. So whatever I explained was more on the logic why we need to do all these things. The next part is, okay, how do we actually develop a control, guidance and navigation system for an underwater robot? So for that, as I told you, we know that, okay, when there is a buoyancy, it will go like this when commanded. But how do I know what will be the approximate buoyancy needed and what will be the approximate control thrust I need to provide? Because all these things to be pre-programmed. So if I want to do all these pre-programmed, I need to know everything about the robot. All the information I should have as a designer, I need to know everything so that I know what is to be done when something goes wrong. Suddenly, suppose I made it just neutrally buoyant. Okay, I made it just neutrally buoyant. And I put it in Arabian Sea or Bay of Bengal. Okay, is there any difference? If I put in Arabian Sea and Bay of Bengal, where there will be any difference in this robot behavior? Yes or no? Yes? Why? Yes, there is a density difference between these two seas. Okay. So the buoyancy force basically is a function of density of water. Okay. So when you design something neutrally buoyant for Arabian Sea and you take it to the other sea, it will not be neutrally buoyant. So it will be actually having a positive or negative buoyancy depending on, okay, what the variation is. So